G'day, it's Rowan from Ferguson Brothers Rail. We're going to hit the workbench today and have a look at my 10-step checklist for modifying Electrofrog turnouts for reliable and maintenance-free running on DCC layouts. I'll explain why you need to do this and we'll go through exactly how. If you've already gone down the Unifrog pathway, you've made a wise decision. This is specifically about modifying Electrofrog turnouts for a substantially better model railway. We'll use a simple jig to make this process much easier. I work in N scale, which is the hardest due to its size. You'll see why as we get into it. If you're modelling in HO or 00, the same principles apply. It'll just be a bit easier. You'll need some basic confidence with a Dremel and a soldering iron, and I'll assume you understand how to tin surfaces for effective joints. I'll be sharing tips throughout the video, so stick around. Let's start by looking at the why. First of all, I'm not going to talk about Unifrogs at all. The reasons for this are outside the scope of this video. For a reliable and low-maintenance DCC layout, we'll be discussing Electrofrogs and Unifrogs. Here's the best tip of all. If you haven't purchased your turnouts yet, just buy Unifrogs. I had about 20 Electrofrogs already purchased, which is why I'm doing these modifications. What we're doing here is converting Electrofrogs into Unifrogs. It's possible you might not be able to find Unifrogs in the radius or size you need, in which case there's still a lot of value in watching this video. There are three main reasons we need to modify Electrofrogs for a DCC layout. The biggest problem with Electrofrogs is you're relying on transmitting electrical conductivity through a dry connection. This is right in here where the blades make contact with the outer stock rails. They work fine when they're new, and here's what new looks like straight out of the packet. But very soon, a layer of oxidization builds up on the nickel surface, and you'll be forever cleaning these suckers for reliable running. Here's what an uncleaned one looks like. The level of frustration is multiplied by how many turnouts you have. I have 4 on this whole DC layout, and that drives me nuts. Time's just too short to waste it on pointless repetitive activities. With Unifrogs and our modification, we control the polarity of the frog independently and our turnout is receiving live electrical current all the time. So the blades can relax because now they're only doing one job. They're simply directing train wheels. The frog polarity can be controlled in a number of ways, from any type of point motor or automatic polarity switcher like a frog juicer. The second problem with Electrofrogs is that in their stock form, it's very easy for a short to occur in this section here. You've got opposite polarity running in parallel for a reasonable distance, and this is a common spot for locos to derail. So if your loco derails anywhere in here, you've got a decent chance that contact could be made across these two surfaces. For example, when a metal wheel touches both at the same time, dead short. Finally, out of the box, the polarity of frog rails is the same, and you have to use insulated track joiners on the ends to separate them electrically from the main rails. But you can get shorts here too. Let's say your turnout is set to position A. If a loco creeps up on side B and past the insulated joiner, dead short. With our modification, we'll pretty much eliminate this possibility and also be able to connect all 6 ends of the turnout with soldered metal track joiners.
A gentleman came up to me the other day and said he couldn't subscribe to my channel because he wasn't a member of Google and he didn't want to become a member because he's worried about getting spammed and getting a bunch of email and stuff. I totally understand that. I try and keep low profile online myself these days as well. I can say though that the benefits of having an account outweigh the downsides. You don't actually get hassled very much. I get the odd email about, you know, privacy and security updates, but apart from that, it's pretty handy. I can watch videos that I haven't finished. I can save things. You know, it gives me suggestions for content that I'm more likely to be interested in. And of course, the other side, from my perspective as a creator, I'm never going to be rich out of this. I don't do it for the money. I do it to try and help people. And the only true measure for me that people are watching the channel is by how many people subscribe. So if you're not a member already and you haven't subscribed, please consider doing so. That's all I'm going to say. Let's go chop some turnouts.
Here's the 10-step checklist, and I'll flash up the steps as we go. I'll also add this as a download in case you want a copy. I actually refer to this myself so I don't forget things. The first half of the list is preparation. Step 1. Mark wiring and hole positions. After gluing down your foam or cork track bed, mark the precise location where you'll drill 4 holes through the bench work. There are 2 holes for feeders, 1 for the frog wire, and a bigger one for the turnout motor pin. Then mark on the turnout itself where you'll make the cuts and where the power feeders and frog wire will be soldered on. I use the black to the back principle, where my negative feed is closest to the wall. I use coloured markers so I don't get confused when soldering my black and red feeder wires later. Have you heard how some successful businessmen wear the same suit every day? It removes the first decision-making requirement of the day. Optimise basic tasks so you're saving your brain for things that require more concentration. That's where the coloured markers help me. Step 2. Drill 4 holes. Now I'll drill the holes and double check I can see through the motor point pin hole in both positions. I use a 4mm drill bit for the wire holes, and I use a 6mm drill bit for the motor point pin hole. Sometimes I need to make adjustments with the round file if the drill walks off centre or I'm a little out. This happens sometimes with the frog wire hole because it's harder to mark out. Step 3. Drill out the pin holes. Now this is optional. If you look on the underside, there are 5 divots preformed that give you a starting guide for drilling through. FlexTrack also has these divots, and Cody pre-drills a full box of FlexTrack so it's ready to lay. Okay, so a heap of guys glue track and turnouts and they don't pin. It's up to you. I've always preferred to pin first so we can test branches and districts with rolling stock before committing. When the ballast goes down later, we'll have tested everything thoroughly and be ready to lock it all in then. Having said that, I do solder turnouts and flex track joins at the laying stage, especially curved flex track, because soldering the joins as you lay allows you to prevent kinks. By just pinning though, it means there's enough play to push things around and desolder joints if I need to. We won't cut expansion gaps until the ballast is completely dry, which locks all the plastic tires in place. So skip the drilling if you're a gluer. Step 4. Clear tires and spring. We remove the plastic tires at each end as we'll be soldering the ends with metal joiners. I trim them off with a sharp blade or a pair of snips, whatever's within reach. I also remove the spring at this stage. You may be thinking your point motors are tough little buggers and easily capable of muscling the points with the springs intact. I'm not doubting this. However, I've also heard anecdotally that there's an electrical issue to consider. Pretend you're Ant-Man. The theory goes that when a point with spring is thrown, it takes a number of extra milliseconds to build up the force required to overcome the spring tension and pull it away from its position. And during this seemingly imperceivable delay, the frog polarity has already changed, thereby causing a short. I hope that makes sense. Now, I haven't experienced this myself, so I can't confirm or deny it. Given though, the DCC is particularly sensitive to electrical integrity, I decided not to risk it, so I pull the springs. And if you've adjusted the position of your point or servo motors correctly, you won't need turnout springs to hold the blades tight. As with most things, technique beats force. The easiest way to remove these is to insert an X-Acto blade underneath the spring in its closed position. By closed position, I mean when the spring appears to be sitting flat, not cocked open. Gently twist the blade and it pops out with almost no effort. Okay, it's time for the modification steps. Step 5, isolation slots below the frog. It's time for fearlessness. If you've never used a Dremel, you may want to practice a bit first. I found a cheap assorted parts kit in a local hardware store. I think it was about $20. Most of it's junk, except these little cutoff discs that are thinner and smaller in diameter than standard Dremel cutoff discs. The smaller diameter is particularly important for end scale, where the smaller distance between inner closure rails requires careful cutting. It's worth even wearing one down a bit to make it smaller first. I also use an extension snake on the Dremel so I can get a perpendicular cutting angle. A medium speed is better than a slow speed, and by using the jig, your hands are free to keep the cutting head steady. These little discs snap easily, so protect your eyes and face if possible. I'm fortunate to have a lit magnifying glass, which offers protection as well as better vision. This is the jig. Very simple, a piece of wood with insert nuts so I can tighten it down with four bolts. Insert nuts are very useful. I always have a jar on the shelf. The purpose of the jig is twofold, to hold the turnout nice and steady and offer a sacrificial edge so you don't accidentally cut the outer stock rails. You can see here all the nicks in these. They're here instead of my turnouts. I'm using 3mm MDF on either side so the metal plates sit flat when clamping down on the turnout. You want the metal sheet pretty flat but also rigid. I used an old road sign, which is probably about a millimetre thick. The holes here are oversized so I can adjust the jig for various turnout sizes. Right, I usually cut the slots on the middle part of the turnout first. I'm avoiding the plastic ties beneath the rail, and I'll choose a spot fairly close to the frog. What we're doing here is isolating the frog from the rest of the turnout. Step 6, isolation slots above the frog. Now onto the frog rails, which is the V at the end of the turnout. A word of warning, by cutting this, you're reducing the fixture points between the metal rails and the plastic ties beneath. It's only being held by one or two ties once you cut through, so I'll usually flood it with a bit of super glue straight after the cut. This warning extends to soldering the track joiners on later too. If you hold the iron on too long, you'll melt the ties, which can result in the track moving out of alignment. This happened to me on a complex crossing configuration, so I had to perform some very detailed plastic surgery. Super glue is your friend, just make sure it doesn't form an insulative layer between the rail and the wheels of your locos. Step 7, cutting the frog wire. We want to isolate the frog, so we'll be snipping its stock wire. Now don't forget, you've already cut the frog wire hole through your benchwork, right? Once we've got wires poking up from underneath the turnout, it won't sit flat anymore, so it'll be harder if you need to go back and mark out holes on the layout. If I'm worried that my cuts didn't go all the way through, I'll do some continuity checks with my multimeter to ensure there's no electrical connectivity. Step 8, cutting slots for bridging wire. Now we need to prepare a space to solder bridging wire from the outer stock rails to the inner closing rails. This is what provides the turnout with its fully live status, which is fundamental to why we're doing all this. I use a modelling saw for straight cuts across four ties in one go, then file the exposed rails for a nice contaminant-free soldering surface. Step 9, soldering wires. The next step is to tin a couple of feeder wires. I've stripped off a decent amount of insulation so there's enough length of exposed wire to bridge the gap. These feeders serve two purposes. They provide electrical connectivity across the rails, and they also act as power feeders to the main power bus. Side note, every turnout and independent section of track in our layout has power feeders, and I like to solder mine underneath so they're completely invisible after ballast. Some guys don't care about soldering off the side of the rails, that's your call. A good tip for soldering the frog wire is to let the tip you tinned rest down against the bottom of the turnout. Then you're not waving it around in the air trying to be still while heating both surfaces. It makes it easy to achieve a reliable joint along both surfaces of wire, and you won't need any heat shrink. Step 10, installing the layout. We install our track from one direction, so working our way around the main line, adding track and turnouts as we go. This helps you control curves and join gaps without kinks. I already have my track in position, so now I'll just slide the turnout on, pin it down, and then solder the join. We use this little track joiner jig I made. The joiners can only slide onto the jig halfway, which makes it really easy to slide them into position without pushing in too far. The power feeders will be used for two purposes. They'll carry current into the turnout, and I'll also send them into the switch of our point motors. Each time the point motor is activated, the switch allows the correct polarity through to the frog. We'll look at this in more detail in a future video. Here's a temporary switch setup to demonstrate the final outcome. Using the multimeter, you can see we've got positive power throughout this entire section of the turnout. Polarity has been sent to the frog via the switch in my motor. The turnout is soldered at both ends through metal rail joiners for complete electrical and physical reliability. I can creep a loco right up close on the traverse rail and no shorts occur. In addition, in this area where the blade and stock rails run closely in parallel, the polarity is the same. So if a loco was to derail here, no shorts would occur if metal wheels made contact with both surfaces.
Thanks for watching the video, guys. I hope this has helped you understand why it's important to modify electrofrogs for maintenance-free and reliable DCC running. If you haven't already purchased any points, the best advice I can give you is just go and buy Unifrogs. But like me, you may already have some electrofrogs, or you may not be able to find the sizes you need. So that's where this modification can come in handy. It's not really all that hard. With the jig, it makes things a lot safer and a lot more easy. Now, in an upcoming video, I'm going to talk about building a wood grain finish switch box to control these points. So I hope to see you on that one. Bye for now.